Next, we have Dr. Venkatraman Garu to talk on medical nutrition therapy for sarcopenia. I don't think Dr. Venkatraman Garu needs any introduction.
So good morning. Thanks, chairpersons, for the introduction. And good morning to you, ladies and gentlemen. So in the next 10 to 12 minutes, I'm going to talk about an aspect of nutrition which probably there's a benign neglect on the part of the clinicians. When we talk about diet, in the context of dietary recommendations, say in health as well as in disease, always quite justifiably we focus on carbohydrates, the fibers, the fat. When it comes to proteins, there is a silent approval of the diet, which is probably deficient in proteins. This, in my opinion, at least in the context of diabetology practice, is primarily driven by the impact the nephrologists have had on us. Once a patient has got CKD, ESRD, I think we are driven away by the Brenner's hypothesis of single nephron GFR. We restrict the proteins. The opposite scenario is a case of a pancreatic diabetes, say a person with 165 centimeters of body weight. Ideal body weight should be around 65, is about 50, you just give a liberal amount of proteins. Excepting in such cachectic situations, probably in health, the aspect of protein is slightly neglected. So my aim in the next 10 minutes is to throw some light on this important macronutrient and how supplementation helps in a small study. See, the total proteins in an adult is about 10 to 12 kgs, and 80% of the muscles are made of proteins, some basic physiology to start with. And I would like to focus on this particular point. All of us know that there is an age-related decline in the lean body mass. In fact, the hyperglycemia of aging, one of the pathophysiological reasons advocated is the loss of muscle mass with respect to augmenting the insulin resistance, contributing to senile hyperglycemia. But that apart, from the point of view of nutrition, if you look at it, from the age of 40, there is an 8% loss per decade of peak muscle mass, and this is doubled after the age of 70. So there is a progressive physiological decline in the lean body or muscle mass with aging. And added to this physiological loss, there are other disease conditions or comorbid conditions which could accentuate the muscle loss. And these are the mechanisms which operate in those comorbid conditions which I have listed here. The cancer, obesity, rheumatoid arthritis, etc., COPD. And you can have inflammation, neurodegeneration, endocrine factors, operation, disuse, atrophy, ultimately resulting in frailty. Yeah, physiological decline in the muscle mass, accentuated by certain diseases and exemplified in the ICU settings, can have clinical implications. What are they? A diminution in the immunity and delayed wound healing, propensity for infections because of loss of immunity, and quite surprisingly, it has been associated with a very enhanced risk of mortality. So a seemingly benign loss of one tissue in the body, which is age-related, which is accentuated by the diseases, is associated with a lot of endpoints, right from delayed healing of wounds or propensity for infections up to enhanced mortality. Having said that, conventionally, how do you assess the nutritional status of a patient? I think all of us do it. You do the height, the weight, calculate the BMI. Now, here is depicted in this cartoon three subjects with the same BMI, and what is given in the red is the lean mass. So it is not difficult to conjecture, to appreciate that the patient C has got the maximal lean body mass or muscles, although the other two share the same BMI with this person C. Now, the other side of the coin. Here, I was narrating how if you go by the BMI, you can miss the lean body mass composition of the body, whereas if you resort to some investigative procedures, for example, MR spectroscopy to identify the muscle mass, patients with varying BMI, BMI 17, 25, and 38, all of them have the same amount of muscle. So the conventional assessment of anthropometry, which includes the height, the weight, the BMI, and even some situations, other procedures, might miss the lack of the age-related decline in the muscle mass. So this is called as sarcopenic obesity. So with increased age, there is loss of muscle mass, there is an increase in the adipose tissue component, so that the weight seemingly remains the same or even increased, but even in this individual, as we saw in the examples, with the same BMI, the lean body mass is reduced. And there are various studies, I'm sure, if proper huge large-scale studies are undertaken with objective, good objective assessment, the figures will be much, much more. So, when you talk about the lean muscle mass, it is categorized as activity-related, disease-related, and nutrition-related. So the sarcopenia is associated with enhanced 25% higher incidence of CVD, risk of frailty and poor quality of life, and the hospitalization stay is increased. This is basic physiology. All of us know that carbohydrates and proteins give the same number of calories. And we are very much aware of some of the gym diets which are so rich in proteins. It is a waste of calories, it is a load on the kidneys, it might even be detrimental. Protein supplementation has to be adequate, but the calories have to be taken care of by the carbohydrates and the fats so that the protein is utilized for the muscle building process alone, number one. And number two, some quality proteins have got this added property which we'll see in the next few slides. So when adding protein, it's important that you take care of the calories from the other macronutrients so that the proteins are spared only for the bodybuilding as depicted here. So towards a complete and balanced nutrition, the recommendations are there for 10 to 35% depending upon the various categories. We allow the proteins. Of course, due allowance is to be given by the carbohydrates. The figures are given here. When we talk about the proteins, the quality of the proteins, which is very, very important from the point of view of muscle building, are the protein digestibility content amino acid score, which is called as PDCAAS. As you will see here, the seasoned egg, milk, soya protein, and whey protein have got a good amount of this score, almost nearing one, whereas other protein sources may lack this. So one has to balance it with the protein efficiency ratio as well as the PDCAAS. If you find here, I think the whey protein, the soya protein, and the other proteins listed above score over the other proteins. Carbohydrates, I'm sure, a lot of things have been talked about it. We know that. We always do it in practice. Unsaturated, about the fats, the beneficial effects and the undesirable effect, we know that. For the calories we give, and the micronutrients have to be added. We also know that. So an attributes of an ideal nutrition supplement will be, it should have a high quality protein incorporated with the percentage distribution catering to the physiological demands of aging with superadded comorbid conditions as we discussed previously. Just conclude with a small study wherein one meal has been replaced, this ONS, in some of these disease states which is depicted here, neurological diseases, stroma, etc., and also infections. If you see here, replacement of one nutritional supplement with a good protein supplementation results in an improvement in the muscle mass. One of the parameters to assess is the hand grip strength. There is a dynamometer, which is an expensive tool. Maybe some of the clinics which can afford that, you can have that, so that you have an objective assessment of improvement. So ladies and gentlemen, I think I was able to finish in 10 minutes. An important aspect of macronutrient, that is the proteins, which is associated in a detrimental way as the aging advances. And this figure is huge, compounded by various disease ailments. It is associated with huge clinical impacts from lack of immunity to falls as well as increased mortality. So while planning your nutrition, and also when you want to talk of a nutritional supplement, which we do for our routine diabetic patients, adequate protein concentration has to be there. And we saw a small study wherein replacement of one meal with the nutritional supplement, which is high in quality protein, has been associated with improvement in the hand grip. Thank you.